This is the Liz Harrison Show.
Good afternoon, folks. I'm Liz Harrison. It is Friday, June 19th. Thank you for listening to Vigilant Liberty Radio. If you're catching this on K98talk.com, thanks for listening there. Yes, I did everything backwards. I'm having one of those days. This is what happens when I open up the news feeds in the morning and I see Hillary Clinton saying it's time for a woman president. But she's going to run on the merits of her accomplishments. I love a good punchline. I can't make this stuff up, really. I mean, it's right up there with now pro-choice. They're all upset. Because the Pope says abortion is bad. Wow! Where have they been? I'm afraid to figure out exactly what rock they've been under. Anyway. Gentleman who is on the Vigilant Liberty airwaves, at least in podcast form. I'm going to blame him for this. It's all his fault. You have any complaints, you send this one to Doug Matakonis, the gentleman who hangs out with the Jazz Shaw on the Politinerds, normally on Thursdays. They weren't on yesterday. I didn't know that, you know. Whatever. They had a rough week. Everybody had a rough week. They took the week off. Slackers. Well, he made up for it this morning. He went and he gave me goodies. From NJ.com. Dead people would be banned from driving in New Jersey under proposed law. Yay! No more zombie drivers! Way to go, New Jersey! This is a nice short one. Larry Higgs, how you did this without bursting out laughing, I don't know. But hey, who knows? Maybe you don't have a sense of humor, although with the beard that it looks like you've got, you and the mustache, you've got to have a sense of humor. But anyway, driver's licenses and other documents, we don't know what they are, may no longer be issued to dead people under a proposed law that would require the State Motor Vehicle Commission to check Social Security records. The bill, sponsored by Assemblyman Wayne DeAngelo, Democrat of Middlesex, goes to the full assembly after it was released by the Transportation Committee on Thursday. The bill was introduced after a state audit in March found the MVC issued documents to 300 people whose Social Security records listed as deceased. The bill requires the MVC to run a monthly check against Federal Social Security Administration databases. The March audit reviewed 8.2 million MVC records. Wow! And of course, you know what that reminded me of. Yeah. But let's reach back in time, hop in the time machine to March 11th, 2014. Daily News reports. Mummified Michigan woman seemingly voted in the afterlife, records show. Voting records showed that Pia Fahrenkopf, believed to have died in 2008, voted in Michigan's November 2010 gubernatorial election. The vote may have been an administrative error or something far more troubling. Anyone want to guess which one it really was? I'm not betting on the administrative error. Just saying. Not betting on it. Yeah. But we don't need voter ID. And there's no such thing as voter fraud! Yeah, we all knew the evil Republicans were going to go that way. Evil conservatives, God forbid you sit there and just be happy with the concept that there won't be driver's licenses for dead people anymore. No, you've got to turn it into a voter issue, because God forbid you sit there and not let the other side go and vote on behalf of dead people, or as they do here in Pennsylvania, or although, you know, it doesn't happen. But yeah, we occasionally have people who are in nursing homes with profound dementia or in comas, but somehow they make it to the polls. It's miraculous, I'm telling you, folks. It's totally miraculous. Totally. And yeah, I must have been imagining it whenever I heard a guy talking about using multiple names in the 2008 election and hitting multiple polls over the telephone. You know, when I was working the polls. Must have imagined that. And Jessica, our producer extraordinaire, whenever she is on the air, well, managing the airwaves here in the afternoons, she never saw anybody getting in a van going from pole to pole in Florida voting for Obama either, because it was the right thing to do, right? Okay. Just checking. Anyway. I love delusional people. I really do. It's so much fun. Okay. Now, let me see. What was I promising people I would talk about? Oh, okay. Yeah. QR codes. Who uses them? Seriously? Who uses QR codes? I mean, I know people who do. They unfortunately work for my school district. They are teachers. They unfortunately thought it would be a good idea to yell at me because I wouldn't put a QR code app on my child's phone. You know, they want them to use QR codes in the classroom. Because, you know, what could possibly go wrong? We have never had warnings about QR codes leading people to malicious software, malicious code. Never happens. Nope, never. Okay, maybe it does. And it would never in a million years lead you to somewhere other than where you intended to go on the interwebs. Right? I only have one question. If you're clicking on a QR code, if you're taking a little picture of the QR code on a Heinz ketchup bottle, where do you think you're gonna go? I think you'd go to the Heinz website. Oh, wait, no, not exactly. Heinz had to apologize to a German man who was directed to a hardcore porn site. Yeah, a little bit of early stuff for the Friday show. I'm going to check out the QR code on my Heinz ketchup, and it's going to lead to hardcore porn. Yay. Yeah. Daniel Carell scanned the code, thinking it would lead to a promotional site where he could design his own Heinz ketchup label. Unfortunately, the campaign ran from 2012 to 2014, and the domain expired this year. So, it was snatched up by a German porn site called Funderado. I'm trying to figure this out. Why in the world? I don't get it, folks. I really don't. Anyway, yeah, Heinz made a boo-boo. Little hint, folks, even if you don't have a website anymore for a given thing, it's probably a good idea to keep it, especially, you know, with food products. The contest was running through 2014. I don't know about you. I picked up ketchup. It has an expiration date up to 2 years after, I think. I don't know. Until it starts looking weird, people use it. It would be a good idea to keep your hands on the domain and just put a front door on it until like 5 years later. And who knows, you might decide to do the contest again. That would make more sense, by the way. Finish one contest, move into the next one, keep the stupid domain. Then you don't have to worry about anybody messing with your brand. Best practices in business. Something like that. Anyway. Yeah, it's been one of those days. This is why I don't want my child to use QR codes. Because who knows who's going to buy up the domains that the teachers are sending the kids to look at. Oh. Anyway. Time to get into something relatively serious so that I don't... so that in the second half of the show I could go and stick with fun stuff or something. Yeah. Anyway. We have a lot of talk going on regarding the situation in Charleston and the evil creature. That's what I refer to him as. Evil creature that decided to kill 9 people. He wanted to start a race war. Okay. Some people have started catering to the blame game. Please stop. Please stop. Okay? This is where I say, no freedom of speech here, folks. No freedom of speech here, folks. Okay? There is a GOP Daily Dose. I don't really suggest that people go there on a regular basis. As a matter of fact, I typically ignore them. Sorry, folks. I mean, that's just the way it is. But they are, and of course it leads to WorldNet Daily. We won't give them the pet name that I tend to give, but yeah. I'll try not to. Anyway, they're talking about drugs. Suboxone. Specifically. They're saying that maybe this might be to blame for the evil creature deciding to do what he was doing. Please stop. I don't care. I don't care if he was freebasing God knows what chemicals. I don't care if he was making something in his basement and taking it and snorting it and doing whatever he wants with it. Don't care. Do not care. No. Don't care what anybody gave him. Don't care what drugs he was taking. Don't care about any of those things at all. Do not mention the words drugs. Do not mention the word drugs. Do not mention the word mental mental instability, mental illness, crazy, insane. You see where I'm going here, folks? Do not offer any opportunity for this evil creature to create a defense for his actions that would let him get off. Don't do it. It's pure and simple, folks. He decided to go into that building and shoot people. I don't care why. Because why will lead to an excuse. Why, asking the question why, will lead to an excuse. He's told us why. Okay? He already has. He wanted to start a race war. Okay? In case anybody's wondering, that's indefensible. And that's where we want it to be. Indefensible. Do not turn the perpetrator into a victim. Don't do it. And also at the same time, you know, no matter how much the president wants to blame the weapon, I want to see something. I really do. Because, and if this report is accurate, I heard at the very beginning, this evil creature got a weapon from his father. It was a gift. If that is the case, that the father gave him this weapon as a gift, I want to see the father charged as an accessory. I'm probably not going to get it. But, you know, because this is called taking responsibility for your own actions. It really is. Taking responsibility for your own actions. I'd love to see the roommate charged. I'm not entirely sure with what. And the reason why I say this is because the reports are trickling in. People around this person knew there was something really wrong going on here. But it's none of my business. Not my place to go and say anything. So he's talking about hurting a lot of people, going out shooting people. Not my problem. I shouldn't report that to anybody. No, 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 no. That's none of my business. Really? Yeah, you won't be found criminally culpable, but I hope you suffer through the rest of your life. Never have a single night's restful sleep. Because you shouldn't. You should be plagued with nightmares. Because that's what you did to these people. You turned their lives into a nightmare. The survivors. The family members of those who were killed. You turned their lives into a nightmare because you didn't choose to be responsible. Of course, you know, I was railing yesterday. Taking responsibility for one's own words. Taking responsibility for one's own actions. And I'm sorry. I'm done as far as the people who are claiming to be conservative and saying, yes, you need to take responsibility for your own actions, and then they come up with this Suboxone crap. Really? Go climb in a hole somewhere. Seriously. Hypocrisy. Blaming a bloody freaking drug. No. Sorry, it doesn't work. You can't sit there and say to the left, don't blame other people for bad acts. Don't blame chemicals for bad acts. I do recall, drunkenness is not a defense. You decide to get behind the wheel and you kill someone as a drunk driver. Drunkenness is not a defense. It's not considered a way to get out of taking responsibility for your own actions. Never mind the fact that you have diminished capacity. Doesn't matter. Shouldn't have been behind the wheel. And if anything, if the kid was on any type of psychiatric medication, then that just makes a bigger case against whatever idiot decided to give him a weapon as a gift. It's not about gun control. Two basic rules in life. Two basic rules when it comes to weapons. Criminals and crazies. If criminals really want a gun, they're going to get a gun. It doesn't matter what gun laws you make, they will get a gun. Crazies. No matter what, same deal as the criminals. If they really want a gun, they're going to get a gun. Is insanity a defense? No. And why is that? Let's see. What is the whole point of putting people behind bars? Except for when you're talking about situations where, you know, we have the justice reform movement. To get rid of mandatory minimums and garbage whenever it comes to minimal crimes, typically to do with drugs. And of course, you know, civil asset forfeiture and all of that. Why do people end up in jail? Why do they end up in prison? Or why do we want them in prison? I mean, I never got the whole debtor's prison thing, because if you throw somebody in jail, they can't make money, so they can't pay you back. So that makes no sense. And the same goes for tax and all of that. Even though I really would like to see Al Sharpton behind bars, it would be better if somebody at the IRS would finally send him a freaking bill and actually collect it. Just saying. But seriously, folks, why do we want people behind bars when they are a danger to others? So why should insanity not be a defense whenever you're talking about criminal behavior that results in the death or injury of others? You're a danger to yourself or others. Oh, maybe that would be a good reason to keep you away from the public at large. Maybe that would be a good reason to put you behind bars. See, the primary reason why I have an issue with the insanity defense is because in the few occasions where it actually works, sooner or later, the individual who got off that way may be able to convince mental health professionals that they are no longer a danger to anybody else, and I'm not sold. Believe me, I am not sold. I understand the concept. It isn't very difficult to pull the wool over the eyes of a lot of psychiatric professionals. Speaking from observation and personal experience, because, you know, it used to be sporting for me. I'm not saying that I had been put away or anything. No, I have a tendency of mixing in circles with individuals who are in the psychiatric business, so to speak. It would be always so much fun to sit there and see, well, will they buy this? Will they buy that? And it's mind-numbing. Mind-numbing. How easy it is to pull the wool over their eyes. It really is. And I guess it's because they end up with this false sense of self-assurance. They think, oh, nobody could lie to me. Yeah, they can. I understand the human psyche so much, they couldn't lie to me. I had sick people to lie on them. I would say, go, have fun, let's see if they believe you. And lo and behold, they would. I mean, this is cocktail party type activity here. But it was amusing. I enjoyed it. Because if I had to, you know, put up with them in the first place, I may as well get some amusement out of it. So, yeah. They're not that great. It's not like on TV. And it can often have disastrous effects. The reason why I took up this particular cocktail party activity in the first place was because I had one very special case. A psychiatrist who didn't get it when a friend's child was really having sincere psychological problems was honestly suicidal. And this person gave that teen a clean bill of mental health and sent that teen home. And in under 72 hours after that, the teen was dead. My faith in the psychiatric community in general, and of course there are plenty of other cases like that, cases of individuals who had been determined to be fine and well-adjusted, released from mental health care, and then end up with some disastrous situation, whether they ended up dead or ended up harming someone else. These people are not infallible. I despise the concept of saying that you can go and get away with saying, oh, I was insane, and then these quacks are going to be the ones to determine whether or not it's safe to put you back out in the world. No. Yes, I understand. Human beings are not infallible. There are certain circumstances where you should not be relying on only the opinion of even just a handful. And definitely shouldn't be relying on the opinion of just one. Because I am of the opinion that, you know, the situations that went very badly, including the teen that ended up dead, probably would not have happened if you didn't have a psychiatric professional sitting there saying to themselves, oh, I'm smart enough to figure out what this teen is really thinking, so I can release this person out into the world without consulting anybody else and without having this teen go and talk to anybody else. And when I say that, I mean really talk, as opposed to just a cursory interview on exit from a facility. But hey, that's just me. I understand how the system works to a certain extent, and I really don't approve. We're worried about going and having, you know, all those evil drug dealers behind bars, when we really need to worry about having the people who will actually do some real harm remain behind bars. I hope we don't end up seeing that happen with this person. So please, don't use the words insane, crazy. Don't blame psychiatric drugs. Don't blame anything except the evil creature that did it. Please, just stop. Think about it. Is what I am going to say or write going to give some slimy defense attorney an excuse to get this guy a way to weasel out of spending the rest of his existence behind bars? So if you think that the slimy defense attorney is going to like what you're going to say, don't say it. People need to take responsibility for their actions. We don't need to help them not do that. Anyway, it is the bottom of the hour, so it is time for the news.
I'm Dave Anthony. He's confessed and now charged.
This guy doesn't represent anything more than just being a sick, twisted 21-year-old.
South Carolina Republican Senator Lindsey Graham. His niece went to school with Dylann Roof and says he was strange. The man accused of killing 9 people during a Bible study in a historic black church is due in court later. Fox News Radio's Evan Brown live in Charleston.
Dave, Dylann Roof will appear in front of a judge for a bond hearing this afternoon, but he is now officially charged with 9 murders and illegally possessing a firearm. Those charges came after Roof confessed to Wednesday night's shooting. The incident still has left people here both afraid and hurt. South Carolina's Governor Nikki Haley.
We're a strong, prayerful state. We'll come together and we'll get through this.
And a large prayer service is set to take place today on the campus of the College of Charleston, which is just around the corner from Mother Emanuel Church, Dave.
Yeah, but it could get emotional today for the jury at the James Holmes trial. Prosecutors are planning to call their final witness, a survivor who lost a lot in the Colorado movie theater massacre.
Ashley Mosher was injured in the movie theater shooting. She was pregnant at the time and lost the baby she was carrying. Also, her 6-year-old daughter Veronica was killed. She is apparently the prosecution's final witness, and attorneys for James Holmes have been trying to limit her testimony.
Fox News Radio's Jessica Rosenthal. What ISIS has done in Iraq and Syria and Boko Haram has done in Africa has taken its toll. A new State Department report details a big spike in terrorism last year. Attacks rose 35%, and the number of people around the world killed jumped to 33,000 from 18,000 in 2013. Two accused ISIS supporters are due in court in Boston today, David Wright and Nicholas Ravinsky.
They're accused of working with Boston terror suspect Osama Rahim. Authorities say they originally planned to behead blogger Pamela Geller, but Rahim called Wright on June 2nd and told him he instead wanted to kill police officers. Rahim was killed by investigators who say he lunged at them with a large military-style knife.
That's Fox's John E.J. Powers. Fox News Radio. Fair and balanced.
We first opened about 10 years ago. We were small, just a few of us. But it was exciting. I always dreamt of having my own business. It was kind of slow at first, but things started picking up. We had big plans. But in our wildest dreams, we never, never thought we'd have this much work. Yeah, with so many businesses caught off guard by the storm, Reed Waste Management has never been busier.
What will become of your business after a disaster? Nearly 2/3 of businesses aren't prepared for an emergency. And 40% of businesses that experience a disaster never recover. Make an emergency plan now, before it's too late. For a free online tool that helps you develop an emergency plan to keep your business up and running should disaster strike, visit ready.gov/business. Brought to you by the Federal Emergency Management Agency, the American Red Cross, and the Ad Council.
A victory in court for Planned Parenthood in an abortion ruling out of Iowa. Fox News Radio's Jeff Manasso details it live.
The Iowa Supreme Court rules that doctors can continue dispensing abortion-inducing pills remotely via a video teleconferencing system. Planned Parenthood sued the Iowa Board of Medicine over its 2013 decision that would have required a doctor to be in the same room with a patient. The board cited safety concerns. Planned Parenthood cited an undue burden to women. The High Court decision, unanimous. More than 7,000 telemedicine abortions have been performed in Iowa since 2008. Minnesota has a similar program. Dave.
Jeff, they've now been on the run for 2 weeks, and there's still no sign of Richard Matt and David Sweat, the two escaped killers who broke out of a prison in upstate New York. But they're not the only fugitives out there.
An Associated Press survey finds more than 130 prison escapees nationwide remain at large, many of them gone for decades. Notable examples include a killer who crawled through ventilation ducts in a Texas prison, an Indiana inmate who escaped in a garbage truck, and a Florida convict shipping himself out of prison in a crate. Sweat and Matt used power tools to make their break. A female prison employee is charged with helping them escape. Steve Rappaport, Fox News Radio.
Two men took a flight from Johannesburg to London and didn't pay. But one did with his life, found on top of a British building.
The man is thought to have fallen from a British Airways 747 as it came into land in London. His body found on a roof, roughly where the plane would have been putting its wheels down after a 12-hour flight from South Africa. A second man survived. He was found in the plane's undercarriage and is in the hospital in serious condition. There's no word how the two men got into the plane, but previous cases involved stowaways climbing into the wheel well and then freezing to death at altitude. Alistair Wanglin, Fox News Radio.
On Wall Street, some selling this morning. The Dow is down 31 points. I'm Dave Anthony, Fox News Radio.
Hi, I'm Taylor Millard, co-host of The Right War. here on Vigilant Liberty Radio. I'll give you one simple reason why you need to listen to Liz Harrison and me every Wednesday and Thursday night at 11 p.m. Eastern. You never know when I'm going to put my foot in my mouth. Liz, I've had similar situations with you in bed.
Wait,
what? What? That just came out way wrong. That's The Right War, every Wednesdays and Thursdays at 11 p.m. Eastern, here on Vigilant Liberty Radio.
Hi, this is Steve Hamilton, station director at AltCon Radio, and that sultry voice you're listening to is Liz Harrison on The Liz Harrison Show.
Bust out the windows, put his family on food stamps now. He's a big spender, no food on the table, and the bills ain't paid, cause he's spending on cigarettes and PGA. They'll turn us all into beggars, cause they're easier to please. They're feeding our people that government cheese.
Now, in case you're wondering, yeah, that was the match game theme. Radio listeners who are familiar with, well, background, all that, we will be bringing the match game back to the airwaves. Yes, we will, here on Vigilant Liberty Radio, on next Friday, the 26th. The Conservative Feminist Show will be going all match game style. And anyone who's familiar with the Conservative Feminist Show can tell you that's going to be rather, well, interesting. Yeah. Of course, you know that was a OTNN favorite with Zombie Gene Rayburn, etc. Yes, we will be hunting for contestants. Yes, we are assembling a match game panel. Yes, we will have questions that are probably not related to politics. Yeah. They will probably be just normal, everyday questions. And hopefully we won't end up with any standard answers. I believe the one over at OTNN was butt plug. Yeah, no, hopefully that won't happen. Hopefully we'll end up with some rather creative replies to all of the questions we end up with on air. No, I am not going to tell you who's going to be hosting. That's a big secret. But you have to listen on the 26th. We will have more details here at Vigilant Liberty Radio about that. Otherwise, onward and upward. Basically, we all heard this week, Brian Williams, remember him? The memes just wrote themselves about lying. Yeah. He has been suspended, of course. They are officially dumping him as the nightly news anchor at NBC. But they are moving him to a newscaster role at MSNBC, which of course makes complete and total sense because the news on MSNBC doesn't necessarily need to be accurate. So yeah, it's totally in keeping with the market and, well, standard operating procedures at that network. So, good luck to dear Brian Williams. But the thing that bothered me, you know, going back to the whole concept of take responsibility for your own actions, the Blaze reports. Ex-NBC Nightly News anchor Brian Williams said he told half-truths and exaggerations because of his ego. Quote, I told stories that were not true over the years looking back. It is very clear. I never intended to. I got mixed up. It got turned around in my mind. This came from clearly a bad place, a bad urge inside me. This was clearly ego-driven. The desire to better a story I was already in. That's what I've been tearing apart and unpacking and analyzing. Really? I don't know. Blaming your ego. I'm not going to give him a pass on that one. That's not really taking responsibility. Really isn't. I wonder, is that going to, you know what, he might be writing the manual for Obama. Yeah. Anyway, if anybody was wondering, onward and upward to other political issues. Remember the Ready for Hillary thing? Are you ready for Hillary? No. Yeah, she's hitting the campaign trail hard. Today's headline, one of them. America is ready for a woman president, but she's not going to run on just the concept of her gender because, you know, it would never work out well. I mean, because it's not a proven tactic. It's never been used by Obama to justify the first black president. No, it's never, ever come up. And there's no historical precedence at all because black men weren't given the vote before women. Right? Okay, anyway. Yeah. I'll undoubtedly dig into her entire statement because it's really laughable. She's suggesting that she's going to be running on her record. Of course, her most ardent supporters can't seem to say a single thing that she's accomplished when she has been a senator or the Secretary of State. Oh, wait, Benghazi can't count. That would be a bad thing, wouldn't it? Four people dead. She can't really bring up any of the stuff when she was running from bullets, because that was her Brian Williams moment, wasn't it? Yeah. It's just painful, really. And all the while they're all yelling and screaming about Carly Fiorina and her new definition of feminism, which, by the way, matches the definition of feminism offered by First Wave Feminists. Oh, wait, First Wave Feminists were largely conservative. Oops. Oh, wait, we don't know this history, because, you know, it's not taught. Speaking of history. Thanks to the evil creature. So, and arguably the Supreme Court ruling on Texas and vanity plates with the Confederate flag. We're having a little argument, Confederate battle flag flying over South Carolina, state building. Really? We're going here. I want to know this. I really do. I want to understand. You know, and I'm not going to make a strict comparison, but I at least have somewhat of a clue. You know, because I've got SS soldiers sitting in my family tree. I don't deny it. In fact, I have a tendency of intentionally reminding myself. I get annoyed with Angela Merkel. I get annoyed with all manner of different people in Germany that try to gloss this over. Why? I don't know. Is anti-Semitism on the rise in Europe? Yes, it is, including in Germany. Do I think that if they hadn't intentionally buried the history of the Third Reich, that maybe that wouldn't happen? Hell yes. There's a reason why you embrace the negative in your own history, or a reason why you should. It's called prevention. Prevent yourselves from repeating it. And as for the Confederacy, I'm terribly sorry. The percentage of individuals that actually had slaves, the percentage of people in the South that actually had slaves, is nowhere near what everybody says. The Civil War was not just about slavery. Victors write history, remember? So who wrote it? The North. Why would they lie about it? I don't know, maybe it had something to do with something other than just slavery. It hasn't occurred to anybody. In all of these years, oh wait, yes it has, I hear it from people who have Confederate soldiers in their families, in their family trees, and they have the diaries. And what do I hear? 10 times 10 times 10. It was about property rights. Because slaves were considered property, remember? And why would anyone assume? Why would anyone assume that it only had to do with that property? I mean, we're talking about government here. I know, you want to put Lincoln on a pedestal. It never occurred to anybody that maybe the people were fighting for more than just the right to have slaves? That maybe they were being overtaxed? Maybe the South was being squashed financially by the North to help fund industry? Because recall, we're talking about the beginnings of the Industrial Revolution here. We went straight head-on from the Civil War into the Industrial Revolution. It did not occur to anyone. Really? It didn't? Wow. Because why would these people who didn't own slaves fight in a war to defend slavery? Why? We have a lost history here, folks. It's not just about that. And even if it was, please explain. Why wouldn't you want a reminder? Oh, wait, I forgot. You might get your feelings hurt and all of that. Yeah, okay, that's fine. I mean, I want to understand. I really do. Because you started with the negative terminology, the racist pejoratives. claiming them for your own. And why aren't you sitting there and turning the Confederate flag into, like, the scarlet letter? If you want to be proud of that, then go ahead. But you're just showing your bad side. And I'm devil's advocate here, you know. Symbology. Symbols have strength, right? Okay. I'm sorry, I'm just a wee bit frustrated and annoyed by it, because I understand that it's far more complex than what anyone is making it out to be. I'm just waiting for the truth to finally out, but it never really does. Anyway, I promised I was going to go and end things on a high note. And, well, literally so. How about that? Literally so. We're going to have some helium talk, because, you know, it's fun.
Fantastic. What is this? Is this my birthday?
No. The last time I was on this show, you said to me, was I aware that people impersonated me? Then I heard that the very next night, Benedict Cumberbatch and you had what is described as a Rickmanoff.
It's a famous game people play.
So, apparently these are the Jimmy Fallon truth-telling machines.
Yeah.
So I just want to know what you have to say about that. Breathe it in.
This is really like a James Bond show. This really is.
I'm very sorry you were offended. I'm very, very sorry. And welcome to the show.
Apology accepted.
Yeah. When I try... Can I ask you a question?
Yeah.
You did 8 movies with a character. What was the name of that character again that you did the movies and all the based on the books?
Get a good in.
Professor Snape. No. The young boy with the scar on his, yeah.
Exhale and then inhale, yeah.
This is very difficult, but it's Harry Potter.
Aha, that's what I'm talking about. Thank you for being here. And I think, yes, it turns out, because you were just on the show, and then Benedict brought up that we're both fans of yours.
Ha. All right, that would be Jimmy Fallon and Alan Rickman. I'm sorry, I love Alan Rickman. Alan Rickman can make a movie good. Alan Rickman can make me watch a movie that everybody says is absolutely horrible. So, of course, we've made that observation on Friday nights before. And hey, it's always bonus to hear helium voice Alan Rickman say Harry Potter. Brilliant, I tell you. Absolutely brilliant. Of course, now I'm going to have to go look up the Benedict Cumberbatch and see the Rickman off, because, you know, full circle or something. Gotta find that. Anyway, like I said earlier, we are having that New Deal thing going on over on, well, on the Conservative Feminist Show, doing the match game. Yeah, there will be a somewhat sexy twist to it. There would have to be, you know, because we're kink-servative. But we're not going to be over the top, just so that people aren't terrified. It should be great fun. You should be listening in shortly here on Vigilant Liberty Radio. We'll have some promos and teasers and all that sort of fun stuff. over the next week. Otherwise, it is going to be Father's Day this weekend. So, you've got to remember. Got to remember Dad, right? Yeah. Anyway, Rasmussen went and said, we're not really excited about the importance of the holiday itself, but the importance of fatherhood. Yeah. So they don't like the holiday. But 70% of voters say being a father is the most important role for a man to fill in today's world. So there you go. 70% of the people think that's a very important role. Anyway, it is almost about that time. I cut a little bit early on Fridays because, you know, right after this we have Sounds Right with Jennifer Van Lauren Scott Council. They will be on the air at 1 p.m. And then after them, The Right Mics at 2 p.m. And after that, because Rod Eccles has been off this week, we have The Conservative Feminist Show, tonight at 10 p.m. Eastern. You do want to tune in, because, of course, there will be some more information about that match game deal coming up. And otherwise, I've already started going and sending stuff to Mariah, so it should be a very interesting show. Have a great day, folks. I am out of here.